VNIT Nagpur. Professor, you have any question?
Sir, how we calculate solid angle for hemisphere?
The question by one of the participants is how to calculate solid angle for an hemisphere. So, we have done that. For a sphere we have done. Now, you can go ahead and integrate with respect to what is that?
Solid angle is dAn by r squared. So, the solid angle therefore, for a full sphere is going to be 4 pi. dAn by r squared would be 4 pi. Instead of integrating from this way, I take the appropriate limit. So, this what is it? This angle goes from 0 to pi by 2.
Theta and that is 0 to 2 pi. That is theta is 0 to pi by 2 and phi is 0 to 2 pi. You will essentially end up with getting an equal to 2 pi r squared instead of 4 pi r squared.
And then put it here, you will get the hemisphere.
Is that okay, professor?
Sir, my second question is related to convection, sir.
Okay.
In convection, volumetric bit is equal to 1 by T. That is for a perfect gas. But for liquid metals, can we use this equation beta equal to 1 by T?
Okay. So, no, we cannot use this. We cannot use that. You are very right. The question asked is, for perfect gases, we can take beta equal to 1 by T, but for liquid metals and all, can I use this? No, we cannot use this. This is applicable only for perfect gases. That is what in the class yesterday I told that for that problem which we solved specifically, that was air, that is why we took beta equal to 1 by T infinity, but generally we should not take beta equal to 1 by T infinity, we should give the properties. If we see the properties, generally they are given directly as g beta by alpha nu. If you see Professor Bajan's book, he directly gives g beta by alpha nu, but the point is beta has to be obtained, it is not going to be 1 by T infinity. Is that okay?
How we find the beta for liquid metals from the tables or which table?
Yeah, how do we get the beta for liquid metals from the tables? Yes, the answer is we will get it from the tables. Someone has measured it and tabulated as a function of temperature. So, beta we will be taking it from the table.
JNTU Hyderabad.
JNTU Hyderabad, any questions, professor? Why cell phone radiation is harmful to human beings? Honestly, I do not know the answer, but I think that again cell phone radiation is again electromagnetic waves, but I do not know their frequency. See, I think the frequency of the cell phone waves is much lower than what we are talking as thermal radiation. That is why they will carry large energy, as we saw E equal to h nu. So, they are, I think, low frequency waves, but we have to check out. That is why they will probably hurt our biological tissues. That is the theory, but this is not actually proven theory that indeed the cell phone waves are going to affect. There are two schools of thought. One school of thought is that these cell phone waves, whatever electromagnetic waves are emanated from because of the cell phone electromagnetic waves, they are going to hurt or harm the biological tissues. Another school of thought says nothing doing, they are not going to hurt. So, there is no clear evidence that it is indeed going to hurt or not going to hurt. There is no correlation directly available. But nevertheless, what we can go back and check is that what is the energy pertaining to cell phone electromagnetic waves, we can check out. That is, what is the frequency of these waves which are emanating from cell phones, we can check out. In fact, there is a theory also that sparrows have vanished because of cell phones. If not cell phones, at least that cell phone, what is that?
Tower.
Tower, cell phone towers. But these are all theories only, there is no direct correlation. Anything else you want to add over this question?
How does medium affect radiation? Okay.
Okay. The question asked is, how does medium affect radiation? See, if we see in the first transparency, in the very first transparency what we showed in the morning, what did we say? Now, if you see here, the first thing is said, we said that the wavelength equal to speed of light, speed of electromagnetic wave in that medium, that is, sorry, lambda equal to c upon nu, where c is the velocity of wave in vacuum and the velocity of the electromagnetic wave in that medium is given by the speed of light in vacuum upon n. So, that is n is the refractive index. There are two things here. N is the refractive, if it is a perfect vacuum or air, if it is non-participating, that is if it is a vacuum or air is also generally non-participating, in that case the refractive index is 1. That means my wavelength is not getting distorted, number 1. Number 2, if it is non-participating means, we will see later on in the today's lecture, we will not have absorptivity, transmissivity, reflectivity involved with any of, because of this medium. That is, I took an example in the morning, that is if I take an enclosure that is this room and it is filled with air and this is non-participating, that means one wall's heat will interact with the other wall directly, the air is not participating. But now let us say this room is filled with soot. Soot is having lot of absorptivity. Soot is having lot, soot means what? You have burnt some wood in the middle of the room, let us say. Soot is filled all over the room. The soot is going to absorb some of the thermal radiation which is coming out from one wall and trying to reach the other wall. So, it is starting participating. So, participation is usually quantified in terms of refractive index of the medium, and in fact, the absorptivity, transmissivity, reflectivity of the medium are represented in terms of refractive index. In fact, if I have to go overboard and say this refractive index will have, what is that, imaginary component and the real component, usually the real component is the absorptivity. So, anyway, let us not get into that much detail, but the point is the participation is usually quantified by the refractive index of the medium.
One other way of looking at it, not from a radiation point of view, but from, if you are thinking from a light point of view, in winter season you see lot of news about fog delaying trains, etc. What it means is that your visibility is reduced completely or to a great extent. So, if you are shining a light, you would have seen pictures on television, the train is coming, the light is not even seen by the cameraman. So, because there is so much of moisture present in the air, you are not able to see the light. If the moment the sun comes out at around 12 o'clock or something in the afternoon, the same train, the same cameraman, same light are able to see much better. That is because of the, what you say, the amount of moisture in the given space has reduced. So, this probably is a little bit easier to understand for participating. That means the particles of water vapor which are there are actually taking away whatever you can see. Okay, it is forming like an opaque medium in between the light and the observer. So, if the medium is going to act along, if it is a passive, if you are a participant in a classroom and you are sitting in one corner and not bothered about what is happening, you are passive, non-participating. But if you are actively interacting, you are going to be interacting or you are going to be participating. So, the medium is not participating, it doesn't care what is happening between the two surfaces, it is there, it is not there, it doesn't make any difference. But when it affects the interaction, that is called as participating medium. Okay?
This effect is only with reference to thermal radiation, that is heat transfer. Okay.
Sir, my question is in convection heat transfer. How does Prandtl number and Reynolds number varies in capillary tube for two phase fluids, I mean liquid and vapor phase?
Okay, the question is, in capillary tubes, how does Reynolds number and Prandtl number vary, especially when there are two phase flows?
Why capillary tube?
Okay, the answer, let me elaborate the way I have understood it. Capillary tube is almost like a micro channel. In fact, one of our colleague here started off with micro channel measurements with capillary tube. So, what I understand capillary tube is, whatever tube you get in the inside the thermometer is the capillary tube. So, he just broke the thermometer and did the experiments. So, now what is capillary tube? Essentially, the diameter is very small. If the diameter is very small means, my pumping power required is very high. You have seen yesterday in our derivation, delta P in a channel is inversely proportional to diameter. That is, delta P is proportional to 1 upon d to the power of 5. So, as the diameter comes down, the pressure drop is very high, so so much pumping power goes up. So in the capillary tube, my point is, in the capillary tube essentially the flow is going to be laminar, it is not going to be turbulent most of the times. 99% of the time I can say that the flow is going to be laminar. It is very difficult to get turbulent flow in a micro channel, that is in a capillary tube, because you are pumping power. Even if you put 10 bar pressure, you are going to get 10 bar pressure drop also, you are going to get a velocity, you are going to get a very low velocity as long as you are taking a liquid. If it is air, perhaps you can still manage to get turbulent flow. Generally in a capillary flow it is laminar. Now I am answering with reference to single phase flow. So then if it is laminar, we have seen in the basics yesterday that the friction factor is dependent only on Reynolds number, and Nusselt number is not dependent on either Reynolds number nor Prandtl number. So as far as the heat transfer is concerned, it is only going to be either 4.36 if it is constant heat flux, or 3.66 if it is going to be constant wall temperature. For pressure drop, it is going to be 64 by RE. Now for two phase flow, if you ask me, it is a two phase flow in a micro channel. So it is quite difficult, yes, but I can, yes, I can answer in capillary flow also little bit better. See, generally in capillary tubes, yeah, very good. In capillary tubes, what happens is the nature of the flow, the flow pattern, if I imagine it is water and vapor, if I imagine, generally it is bubbly flow. Generally it is bubbly flow, but not always, not always, generally. When I say bubbly flow, I can imagine that fluid as a homogeneous fluid. Yes, what I mean by homogeneous fluid is there are two phases, that is, one is liquid and another one is vapor. But I will imagine a third fluid which is having a properties which are equivalent to the combination of liquid and vapor, and I will define equivalent viscosity, equivalent density, and so I will go ahead and define equivalent Reynolds number. But this is too simplistic an answer for two phase flow. I have answered for your question only for single phase flow. I have not answered for two phase flow. Two phase flow, what you have asked is actually two phase flow in a micro channel. Over to you.
Sir, one more question, sir. How would be the thermal boundary layer and hydrodynamic boundary layer for same two phase fluids, whether it is condenser or evaporator in a refrigeration system?
Okay. See, in a condenser or evaporator, how does thermal boundary layer and hydrodynamic boundary layer develop? See, it develops, definitely both hydrodynamic boundary layer and thermal boundary layer develop, but the way they develop depends on the flow pattern. Let us say if I take stratified flow. When I say stratified flow, what it means is that, yeah, so what professor is drawing is a stratified flow, that is, the denser fluid will flow at the bottom and lighter fluid will flow at the top. Then what is happening? In fact, we have answered this question yesterday also. So what will happen? Boundary layer will grow on the top also, on the vapor side, and boundary layer will grow on the bottom also, on the liquid side. And in addition, there is interfacial shear stress. There will be boundary layer between the two also. Because why? We said boundary layer will be there as long as there is a relative velocity. Now there is a relative velocity between liquid and vapor. Vapor tends to go fast, liquid tends to go slow. You would have seen liquid velocities would never exceed 0.3, 0.4 meters per second, but the vapor velocities can be as high as 4 meters or 10 meters per second. So there is a boundary layer growth at the interface also, and also on the, let us say if it is flow between two parallel plates, on the top wall and the bottom wall. So that is how we have to handle. We have answered only for stratified flow. If you now say it is going to be, let us say, slug flow or what other flow pattern, annular flow, it is all going to be difficult to answer. But definitely boundary layers are going to be there even in two phase flow.
See, one other thing with respect to condenser and evaporator, what will happen is that, condensation will happen in such a way that you will have, if it is like a vertical pipe, condensation will form something like this, okay. So vapor will be here, liquid will be here. So this is called as an annular flow. So the bottom line is, depending on
the distribution of the liquid and vapor phase in that geometry, which we call as flow pattern. Depending on that, you will have the same fundamentals associated to single phase fluid mechanics applied. Only thing that you have to worry about is the what is the nature of flow pattern. If the condensation rate is very, very small, the nature of flow pattern will be very different. If the condensation rate is very high, it is going to be different.
Okay. See, one point I want to add, why our basics are going to be so good, so important. For example, you were asking condensation. In case of condensation, in fact, if you see correlation, which is the most used correlation for condensation, for design of condensers, is again non-dimensionalized using Dittus-Boelter only. This nu naught is the Nusselt number, which is used for single phase flow Dittus-Boelter correlation, which is used in which all the properties are calculated at saturation temperature. That is nu naught. But what is there on the right hand side? It is a function of thermodynamic quality. That is all. Otherwise, for condenser also, Nusselt number is again a function of Reynolds number, Prandtl number. In addition to Reynolds and Prandtl, you have what is called as thermodynamic quality. This is what we do for condensers. If you want many more details on this correlation, what I am talking about is what is called as Shah's correlation, which is the most extensively used correlation for design of condensers. If you want more details on this, you please Moodle. We will send you the notes what we teach for heat exchangers, that is for condenser design. We will send upload that. Is that okay, Professor? Thermic fluids, as far as I know, it is the thermic fluid which we had used in our lab is ethylene glycol. Why do we go for ethylene glycol? Is that the Prandtl number? I remember. What do I remember? I don't remember. Just give me a minute. For high temperature applications we use, and its viscosity is equivalent to water. These thermic fluids are generally used for thermal storage applications and for chiller applications. Why? Because its viscosity is such that it's almost equivalent to that of water, but the Prandtl number is high because its specific heat is high. Its specific heat is high, but the viscosity is as much as that of water, but not as that of oil. Because for thermal storage, the obvious choice would be high Prandtl number, that is high CP fluid. But when you try to go for high CP fluid, which is usually oil, the negative point of the oil is that its viscosity is high. But if viscosity is high, your pumping power goes up. In order to keep your pumping power low, but still try to get the advantage of high specific heat, you use this thermic fluid which is having high CP but low viscosity. Low viscosity is the viscosity not as much as that of oil but as much as that of water. So that is what is called as thermic fluids. We have used this in chiller, but in thermal storage, that is for solar power plants and all, here in one of the applications in solar power plants, thermic fluids are used. So these are essentially what I said: high CP, low viscosity fluids. That is the summary of the question.
Sir, my question is regarding the basics of radiation. You mentioned about electromagnetic waves, that it is a vibration of molecule which we take as a sinusoidal wave. But when you go to basics of radiation, we mention it travel through vacuum where there is no molecules. So can you please elaborate on this?
Yeah. Mechanism of emission, we said that. The question is a mechanism of emission.
Not transport.
See, this is the question asked is in the emission, while emitting, there is we said that the electrons are oscillating, because of which we can imagine that this oscillation as a sinusoidal wave. That's what we have studied in plus 2 also. For a simple pendulum, there is an oscillation. So, but then in a perfect vacuum, how can it get transmitted? That is the question. See, these two are two different things. When we said this with reference to this transparency, it is emission. Emission, where is the emission happening? Emission is happening on the surface. And we also said that radiation, we consider the emission only at the tip of the surface. So we are not taking it as a volumetric phenomena, we are taking it as a surface phenomena. If it has to emit, the electron on the top surface has to vibrate and generate a wave form. So that is all we are saying. energy, this is released because of the oscillations of the electrons at the surface are emitting electromagnetic waves. That's all. That's all the answer. So, we should not get confused with emission and
propagation.
So, what you are telling is propagation, what I have told is emission.
Sir, one more question.
Yeah.
We have studied Reynolds analogy.
Okay.
So, can you please explain with a practical example how it can be used in practice?
One of our professor uses, the question asked is, what are the practical applications of Reynolds analogy? See, if we go back and use, if we just say that, we all know that doing experiments with heat transfer is, sorry, fluid mechanics is much easier than doing measurements with heat transfer. Now, let us say, I said in the Reynolds analogy, Stanton number equal to Cfx by 2. Now, if let us say for flow over a flat plate, as I said, doing pressure measurements are easy and the measurements with pressure or fluid dynamic measurements have lesser uncertainty. I have also told in the yesterday's class that typical uncertainties in fluid mechanics are 6% and typical uncertainties in heat transfers are more than 10 to 15%. So, if I do pressure measurements and estimate Cfx, and let us say this is for air. Why I am taking air? Because my Prandtl number is equal to 0.71, which is closer to 1, which is closer to 1. It is not equal to 1, but it is closer to 1. Then in that case, I can assume that Prandtl number is equal to 1. Then my Reynolds analogy, one of the conditions for the Reynolds analogy to be valid is that Prandtl number should be equal to 1. So, for air, Prandtl number is closer to 1, that is the closest one can get. So, for air, if I have done pressure measurements and measured Cfx by 2, without measuring, I can now get Nusselt number because nu by REPR equal to Cfx by 2. So, let me write it slowly, nu upon REPR equal to Cfx by 2. So, Re I know because at that Reynolds number only I have measured the Cfx now, and Pr I know because it is 0.71. Now, I can get Nusselt number. From Nusselt number, I can infer heat transfer coefficient. The point is, if you have done fluid dynamic measurement, you can get the heat transfer coefficient. This is what I used to think earlier, but one of the professors in our aerodynamics lab, that is Professor Menenges, he uses reverse way in supersonic flow. Interestingly, I was thinking that for supersonic flow, Reynolds analogy is not valid. Interestingly, for flow over a flat plate, in supersonic flow, he measures actually Nusselt number and infers the Cfx. Very interesting it is. And he says that measurements have demonstrated that even for compressible flow, Reynolds analogy works. So, of course, there are assumptions. In fact, when we did all this, we have done for incompressible flow. Most of the times when you do measurement, you come up with this conclusion that Nusselt number, this Reynolds analogy is working. So, the point is, if you do one measurement, you can do away with the other measurement if you apply Reynolds analogy. That is the beauty of Reynolds analogy actually. In fact, people say that even in subcooled boiling, people have seen that Reynolds analogy is working, but it is little difficult to understand because in a pipe flow, there is a pressure gradient. That is the another condition. For the Reynolds analogy to work, we made two conditions to be valid. That is, one should be Prandtl number should be 1 and there should not be pressure gradient. Otherwise, in my momentum equation, I have dp by dx and in my energy equation, I do not have this pressure drop term. So, but people have observed that even in two phase, that is subcooled boiling, Reynolds analogy works. So, in spite of having these conditions not being met, here and there, they do, Reynolds analogy works. Okay.
Early in the morning, in the second or third transparency, you have told us that by giving the example of that campfire and the person,
that
you told us that whatever the temperature of the air remains constant in between that person and the campfire. So, I can't understand how that temperature remains constant for the air.
Okay.
There will be no convection.
So, the question is, actually, I have a campfire and I have a human being, and what is not able, what we are not able to understand is how does this air which is sitting in between is not going to get heated up at all. So that is the question. So let us look at it in a different way. So we have a campfire. What is the temperature of the campfire? 900 degrees Celsius. What is the human body temperature? 35 degrees Celsius. So 37.5 degrees Celsius. Now, because of radiation, because the electromagnetic waves are traveling from fire, they are able to reach the human body. Now, let us say instead of this air, if air were to be highly participating, that is, if they are going to absorb all the radiation which is coming out from the fire, then I would not have received any heat. Now, if I have to not receive any radiation, what should I do? I should put an asbestos sheet in between the fire and myself. So, what is this asbestos sheet doing in between? Why am I not feeling the heat now? Asbestos sheet is absorbing almost all of the heat. Why? Because its absorptivity is very high. Reflectivity is very minimal and transmissivity is almost zero for a solid body, especially for asbestos sheet. That is what we do know. That is what the firefighters do when they go near fire. They keep asbestos sheet. I do not know whether you have watched or not. The material, whatever they keep, they are all about asbestos sheet. Now, if I remove the asbestos sheet, I am filled. What is the medium which is in between the fire and myself?
Air.
Air. But air is having almost nil absorptivity. So, it is not absorbing any of the thermal radiation which is coming from the fire to myself. So, that is why I am absorbing almost all of the heat, or I am able to receive all the heat. So, of course, air also gets heated up slightly. When I say this, I am saying with a pinch of a salt, it is getting heated up slightly, but not to a greater extent. Why? Because it is reasonably non-participating medium. In fact, this is the example quoted. This example I have taken from Chengal. This example is given by Chengal. So, I think this is a very good example. I hope you have understood now. The crux is that whether my medium in between the source and the sink, is it participating or not? If it is not participating, everything reaches the sink. If it is participating, some of it only reaches the sink. As much as my participating medium allows the radiation through it. That is the answer for your question.
So, I have got a quick question regarding boundary layer theory, the basics. So, my question is, in fluid mechanics, we have the local velocity and the mainstream velocity ratio u upon u infinity given as 0.99. And similarly, when we come to thermal boundary layer, we take T minus Ts upon T infinity minus Ts is equal to 0.99. Instead of taking T infinity upon Ts is equal to 0.9 or Ts upon T infinity is equal to 0.99.
Okay.
Why is that, sir?
Yeah. See, this is actually we should have told yesterday, this is a common question. For velocity boundary layer, we take U by U infinity equal to 0.99. But for temperature boundary layer, why don't I take T by T infinity equal to 0.99? Yeah, professor had told this yesterday. Why? Because you see, heat transfer is all because of temperature gradient. What is that which is changing while I am moving up? With reference to the temperature gradient. What is the maximum temperature gradient? I have Ts minus T infinity. So, as I come down, this temperature gradient has to be decreasing. So, in heat transfer, we are worried about temperature gradient, and in the velocity boundary layer, we are worried about the velocity gradient. And interestingly, velocity gradient is at y equal to 0, it is u equal to 0, but at y equal to 0, t is not equal to 0, it is equal to Ts. So, I have to take Ts minus T infinity for temperature boundary layer, and I have to take u by u infinity equal to 0.99 for velocity boundary layer. That is the answer for your question.
One more question, sir. It is regarding radiation.
Okay.
Can we consider a hot tea in a thermos flask as an example? The tea cools after certain amount of time, right? So, why the time is not a variable here?
The question is,
room, it will cool faster.
The question is, if in a thermos flask, whether how, why does the tea doesn't get cooled initially, but with the passage of time, why does it get cooled? So, what is that we are doing in a thermos flask? As I understand, what is that we are doing in a thermos flask? This is my container in which where I have filled my tea, and outside that there is a chamber, and in this chamber I have filled with vacuum. So, what is that? That is, yes, we can give this as an example for radiation. What is the mode of the heat transfer with respect, with reference to atmosphere? It can interact with the atmosphere only through radiation. In fact, if you have closely watched the thermos flask, they are highly reflective surfaces. Reflectivity of the surface is very high because they are not supposed to absorb any heat. So, the reflectivity is very high. So, what is the essential mode of the heat transfer which is taking place between these two plates where the vacuum is there is radiation. But eventually tea has to get cooled. Why? Again, there is a radiative heat transfer. There is no conduction and convection, but there is radiative heat transfer because of which there is the tea will eventually cool. And also this vacuum cannot be perfect vacuum. See, what Professor Puranik, who is sitting by my side, is saying is that if I take tea, the temperature of the tea definitely is varying with time, no doubt about that, because there are other modes of the heat transfer, but for radiation it is only the boundary condition. So, the point is that the tea has to eventually cool with passage of time. I cannot make any system thoroughly insulated. So, this is essentially what we have done is an insulator made by what is that? By maintaining vacuum. But if I, that is what is super insulator, which we were anyway going to touch in radiation. If I have two surfaces and if I evacuate, that's going to, there is no conduction, there is no convection. But then radiation takes place. That's why they put lot of shields. If you put shields, then what will happen? Highly reflective shields, then the heat transfer from this surface to the next surface is impeded. That is what is super insulator, which is used in cryogenic applications. So, and another point I want to emphasize is that here in this vacuum, there is nothing like perfect vacuum. No matter which pump you use for creating vacuum, there will be small amount of air, and that amount of air will create small, not create, will make a natural convection take place. So sum and substance of this question is that yes, thermos flask can be given as an example for radiation, but tea will eventually cool because there is no perfect insulator in this world. Okay. So, now I think we will stop the question answer session and move ahead with the regular lecture.
We looked at this definitions for related to intensity, related to emission, irradiation and radiosity. And before signing off, I told you that what we defined, let me just go back. Here, what we defined, we defined for emission E, we defined G, we defined J. We did not have any subscript of or brackets in them. Those were total hemispherical quantities. So, total hemispherical emissive power, total hemispherical irradiation, that is capital G, total hemispherical radiosity capital J. That means it encompasses all wavelengths, does not care about wavelength, does not care about direction, it relates to the every, it relates to all wavelengths, all possible directions. Okay. So, this was the whole picture. Now, let us break it and go into impose one constraint after another. So, that constraint now we will say is spectral quantity. When I say spectrum or spectral quantity refers to wavelength dependency. So, I had told this already, now you have put this in a logical fashion. So, total radiation quantities which have been integrated over all the wavelengths have been considered so far, E, G, J were total. Okay. Spectral quantities, variation of radiation with wavelength as well as direction, both will be considered in general. Right now, we are saying we will do both together and then we will eliminate one of the dependencies and get the other one. So, spectral directional quantities refer to situations where variation of radiation with wavelength as well as direction are considered, and to express these quantities at a certain wavelength or per unit wavelength interval about lambda. So, this is jargon. Now, let us read the definition and again understand English point of view. Spectral radiation intensity for emitter. What does this tell me? I lambda E theta phi. Okay. So, let me write it without being lazy. I lambda E theta phi. I is for intensity, E is for related to emission, okay. Then lambda in front here refers to spectral. Okay, so this subscript comes because we are talking with a spectral quantity. This refers to emission, related to emission. When I associate intensity related to emission, I will have the subscript. This is our dear intensity. What is intensity again? We have already studied something which is related to the normal. Okay. So, this I will now write is equal to dq divided by, I am flashing this and I will write, is defined as rate. Same definition, exactly the same, we have just added one extra term related to wavelength. Rate at which, that means watt, joule per second watts, rate at which radiation energy dq is emitted, that means by virtue of its temperature is emitted, that is why this emission is here, at a wavelength lambda in the theta phi direction per unit area normal to this direction, per unit solid angle about this direction. Let me just go back to the earlier slide. Rate at which radiation energy dq is emitted in the theta phi direction per unit area normal to the direction per unit solid angle. What is different between this and that definition which I have flashed is that there I have a d lambda, because that is wavelength specific. I told you to imagine red color light. How much of intensity of red color light at a wavelength given by lambda of red light? That is what is given by that definition. So, if I go back quickly, it is nothing but rate at which radiation energy is emitted in the theta phi direction was there. I have introduced an additional word at wavelength lambda. That is all there is. And here therefore, dq by d lambda will come integrated over the differential wavelength d lambda. So, the units essentially will be watt per meter square, steradian for solid angle, micrometer for the wavelength. Then I can write this d omega as sin theta d phi. So, I will have essentially the same units that we had before, dq divided by dA1 cos theta sin theta d phi. This is what we had. This was I E. This was I E theta phi. This was what we defined at 9:30 today. This quantity divided by that is what we write, I lambda E lambda theta phi is equal to dq divided by dA1 cos theta sin theta d phi d lambda. So, right now, if I want to get the total energy, total watts, I have to integrate it with respect to theta, I have to integrate it with respect to phi, and also over the wavelength of interest. That what was done, what was given in the earlier transparency, this quantity was essentially one integration had already been performed. Integration with respect to lambda was already done. This is one more step. This is like the first, we have taken the wavelength dependency out here. Now, we are saying if it was wavelength dependency was there. This is my definition of intensity, okay? Watt per meter square steradian micrometer, that is what is given here, okay? So, if I understand this for emission, the same thing will be valid for irradiation and radiosity. So, the spectral emissive power, let us just do couple of integrations here. Spectral emissive power, so E subscript lambda, that means emissive power relates to all directions. So, I do not care about direction anymore, I am going to integrate with respect to both theta and phi. Spectral hemispherical emissive power, correctly if I have to write strictly, it will be spectral hemispherical because the integration is like this, theta is equal to 0 to pi by 2, phi equal to 0 to 2 pi, it forms a hemisphere. So, I lambda E theta phi, this quantity cos theta sin theta d theta d phi, this I have not integrated with respect to wavelength. So, the subscript lambda will remain. The units for this emissive power would be watts per meter square, was the original units flux. This will be watts per meter square micrometer. Okay. So, this we have to be careful, this is at that wavelength. But when we say spectral emissive power, we are saying it is like a flux only. So, watt per meter square, but we use the word spectral emissive power. Okay. So, do not get confused, this subscript takes care of the fact that you are using the spectral. Okay. So, I am not concerned with other wavelengths, at this wavelength how much is the emission occurring, what is the flux, what is the intensity, what is the emissive power at that wavelength. Okay. So, I do not have to say red light how much is the emission. So, I do not have to use per micrometer there. It is, if I am talking of emissive power associated with red light, then that will be watts per meter square associated with that wavelength. Okay. So, when the variation of spectral intensity I lambda varies like this with lambda, I can just integrate it. The total radiation intensity for emitted, incident and reflected part. Why reflected? Because we need radiosity, we need the reflected part of incident radiation. We can get this by integration over the entire wavelength spectrum. So, total intensity I e is spectral intensity, that is a spectral variation, something like this, integrated over all wavelengths going from 0 to infinity. So, these things will become clear when we do problems. Okay. So, right now these might look like what, double integral, triple integral, so on and so forth, but when the problems are done it will be very clear. So, actually this is the only definition which I have to know. E, total emissive power, is nothing but a total quantity because it is a wavelength independent now. All wavelengths have been taken care because it is a triple integral. One of the integrating limits is lambda to, lambda is 0 to infinity. It is a hemispherical quantity because it has been integrated to form a hemisphere. So, I e lambda theta phi cos theta sin theta d phi was there already. D lambda, if I put here, d lambda is missing here, d lambda here is missing. So, this triple integral should have d theta, d lambda. Okay. So, d lambda is missing in all these three. So, this is the effect of cut and paste. The total E therefore, is obtained by integration of this. Who gives me this function? If I know this function, I can integrate it. Now, these functions will be known to us, we will see in the problems. Some kind of a, in real life functions will be arbitrary in terms of it will be fluctuating, but we can approximate for calculation purposes functions to be straight line, triangular profile, trapezoidal profile, so on and so forth. So, piecewise linear or some geometric representation can be made. Okay. So, similarly total irradiation is intensity I lambda spectral, subscript is I because it is referring to intensity coming in incident, that is why this I, exactly identical. I am not going to even remember cos theta sin theta d phi d lambda, same things here, everything looks same except the subscripts I and E. Lambda has been there, theta phi is there, therefore, it is a triple integral for total, j will be E plus r. Okay, so we can do all these things very easily, and therefore, if everything is diffuse as we saw, E is going to be pi of that intensity. Whether it was spectral quantity or total quantity, this is valid because this has been obtained by integration over all solid angles. Okay. So, with this I will stop. There are problems which we will do now, where these definitions are involved, and once these definitions are over, it is only black body and absorptivity transmittivity. Okay.
So, now I think we have spent ample time, although I was getting restless that we are losing time, but I think Professor Arun has spent enough time teaching us the definitions. So, now with these definitions, that is emissive power and basics, with these basics I think we can move quite fast. There is one simple problem which has been given: irradiation, there is a spectral distribution given, that is from between wavelengths 0 to 5 you have an irradiation of 1000 watts per, this is meter squared, this is watts per meter squared micrometer. So, and from 5 to 20 my irradiation is constant, and again from 20 to 25 micrometer it drops. So, how do I integrate the, how do I get the total irradiation? Total irradiation is integrating over all wavelengths. So, g lambda d lambda between 0 to infinity. So, I get g lambda d lambda 0 to 5 because that nature, linear nature I know, and g lambda d lambda between 5 to 20 micrometer it is constant, and again 20 to 25 micrometer there is particular wavelength, particular irradiation, and 25 to infinity it is 0 because there is no distribution. If I substitute that, the same thing, that is, this is area under the curve. Area under the curve is area of the triangle, that is half into base into height, that is half into 5 into height is 1000. If I do that, I get the area under this curve, that is, this integral can be obtained as half into 5 into 1000 plus 20 minus 5 into 1000, that is again area under the curve. 20 minus 5, 15 into 1000 gives me the area of this rectangle, and again area of the triangle. 25 minus 20, that is half of 5 into 1000. So, if you add up all of this, you are going to get 20,000 watt per meter squared. So, this is how we typically have the spectral irradiation, and this is just a given, a simple example, but you will have all sorts of variations wherein which you will break that into triangles, rectangles, trapezoids and squares. So, this is how. Okay, there is another problem, this is a very important problem. Why I say very important, because you see, I keep saying this always, I take these hands only in my class also, I take the hands only into account. Can you just, yeah, these are the two hands. My left hand is, let us say, at sitting at one temperature, and the right hand is sitting at another temperature. If both are normal, let us say this is dA1 and this is dAn. So, if both are normal, there is no issue. Now, let us say, if the left hand is not normal, it is inclined, what should I do? I have to make it normal. To make it normal, this has to become dA1 cos theta. Okay? It has to be made normal. Similarly, for this also, if it is not normal, I have to make it normal. So, to make it normal, whatever angle is there, that area into that cos theta. So, that is why always we say normal area to the direction of intensity. That is, to the direction of intensity, both the emitter and the receiver are supposed to be normal. And in the solid angle, I am having who is receiving, and in the other area, we worry about the area which is emitting. That is, if you see here, Q1j, that is the, let me reread the question. See, I have area A1, A2, A3, A4, all are of 10 to the power of minus 3 meter squared, and the intensity is 7000 watt per meter squared steradian, that is per unit solid angle, and the question and the distances are all 0.5 meters, but their orientations are not same. You see now, A1 and A3 are normal, the way I showed my hands. A1 and A3 are normal, so let us first find out that solid angle for omega 3 1 is A3 by r squared. I am taking A3 only, why? Because it is normal. Similarly, for 4 also, 4 also is normal to the direction of intensity, but for A2 it is not normal. So, I have to take A 2 cos theta, that is I get A 2 cos theta 2. To make it normal by geometry, you can just work out, I am not going to do that. The angle between, if I tilt this normal to this, normal to this, I am going to get that as 30. So, A 2 cos 30 is what is the normal. So, that is how I get A 2 cos 30, that is solid angle omega 2 1 is A 2 cos 30 upon 0.5 square, that is how I get this solid angle. So, point is they have to be normal. Now, Q 1 j, that is what is the net heat transfer leaving the surface 1 intercepted by surface 2, surface 3, surface 4, that is given by intensity into the area which is emitting this intensity of radiation, that is A 1, but that A 1 has to be normal to the direction of intensity, that is A 1 cos theta. For 3, it is cos theta is cos 0 is 1, that is it is in the, it is normal to the direction of intensity, but that is not so for 2 and 4. So, for 2 and 4, I have to tilt this, tilt A 1 to make it normal to the direction of intensity, tilt A 1 again to make normal to the direction of intensity. So, that tilt angle is cos theta, that is all it is. Here it is cos 45, here it is going to be cos 60. So, that is what I have put that as cos 45 and cos 60, and if you substitute that and if you substitute the solid angles, you are going to get the, you are going to get the net heat flux. You see, there is much you can understand by these numbers. You see, Q13 is higher. Why? Because they are just normal directly, it is see, they are seeing directly each other, that is why Q13 is having higher. Q14 actually is next higher. Why Q14? Because at least 4 is normal, but Q12 both are not normal to the direction of intensity, I have to tilt, that is why the net heat flux is lowest in case of Q14. I mean, this is how you can understand how much heat flux is emitted or received by, whatever is emitted is received by the other surface. That is the beauty, this example shows us how we can understand the solid angle. I think with these examples, we have understood these definitions. We will move on to radiation